Okay, welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the closing panel discussion we're having here in the 20th anniversary LPAP conference about positioning and power in academic publishing, players, agents, and agendas. And it's a pleasure to welcome really a select group of people here representing the different stakeholder perspective that we have discussed over the last days. I think Jean-Claude this morning already gave the right categorization of the different stakeholders, and I think we have a fair representation of them on the podium today. So we have researchers with Andrea Polle here from Göttingen, and they will introduce themselves in a minute. I'm just going through it to show the stakeholder perspectives that we're having here. We're having Laura Henderson from Frontiers with the publisher's perspective, Mike Mertens from DARIAH Europe with a perspective of an infrastructure provider, but also with the perspective of the humanities. So I think you're wearing some kind of a double hat. We have the funders that were also explicitly mentioned in Jean-Claude's presentation as a stakeholder group, with Niels Stern from the Nordic Council of Ministers. We have Andreas Degwitz as a librarian here, and maybe also a little bit with a humanities perspective and an infrastructural perspective, because DINI is a German association of IT centers and libraries, which brings me exactly to Cliff, a renowned expert in our field and representing CNI, a coalition of infrastructure providers in computing centers and libraries. So I would like to invite all the panelists to introduce themselves very briefly, and then we'll start discussing. And we will be open to any questions, any interruptions, screams, applause, spontaneous, and so please engage if you have questions or want to make a comment. But first, let's get to the introductions. I should give you the hand microphone.
Let's see whether this works, and I hope you can hear me. So my name is Andrea Polle. I'm here a local person from the University of Göttingen. My department is forest botany and tree physiology, and actually we do research in molecular ecophysiology. And this means that we really cover a range from molecular biology with, let's say, some overlap to ecology. I'm a member of the School of Forestry, and I'm also an affiliated member of the Faculty for Biology. And so I think I have quite some insights into how scientists perceive the current kind of revolution and how we publish. Maybe I should also mention that I'm also a representative of the Senate of the University of Göttingen in the Foundation Board of the University of Göttingen. And of course, there we have lots of discussion about open access guidelines. And as a member also of editorial boards of journals, and having been a long year member of the trust of the new phytologist, I think I have also some insights at the other side of the coin. And with this, I would like to hand over.
Thank you. I hope you'll forgive me. I just made a couple of slides to show you a little bit about the publisher that I work for and where we come from in the open access environment, if you like. So open access has actually provided many new opportunities for innovation, requiring publishers not just to transfer printing to online, but to leverage the technology that we have available and rethink the publishing model. Frontiers, in our interaction and support of academics, has tried to change that publishing model, make the disruptive innovation that has been talked about earlier today. underpinned by electronic platforms which enable us to fix some of the flaws here, which I won't go through, of traditional academic publishing, which I'm sure you're all very familiar with. So to support our wide range of fully open access, fully digital journals, we just designed some innovative products to help this disruption. To go through. Yep, so we have a collaborative peer review forum which publishes the name of reviewers, and it also ensures that whilst papers are improving, they are still under 90 days in review time. We have article level metrics provided by one of the sponsors of this conference, which is Altmetric. And thanks to that platform, individual article impact can be tracked by views and downloads, also by geographical interest, etc., enabling authors to plan for conferences and other trips where their research might have maximum impact. And we have authors aggregated metrics for their own publications as well. Allow me just to mention here also our network. This is something that Jean-Claude alluded to earlier, that we need to be making better networks for people to communicate and to interact, see each other's research, access each other's research. This is built into the core principles at Frontiers. We have our Loop network, which is open and integrated, links back to other publishers' sites, so never detracts from their views count, and can integrate with other publishers and institutional platforms. Sorry for a lengthy speech there. Over to the next.
I'll try and keep it short then. I'm from DARIAH-EU. And we're the research infrastructure for the arts and humanities in Europe. We're a so-called ERIC, it's a wonderfully romantic name, ERIC. It's a European Research Infrastructure Consortium. But we've been around, we were established as that in 2014, but we've been around on a project basis since 2006. And our aim in life in total is to do several things. So first of all, as an ERIC, we coordinate the contributions of our 70 members across Europe in terms of the tools, platforms, services, texts, and so on and so forth to help help embedding the use of new digital methods amongst the humanities. And we are also attempting to not only support the digital humanists, those who actually identify very specifically with this way of working, but also to encroach upon those disciplines who aren't always that open initially to such methods, as Tara Andrews spoke about in terms of the black box and so forth. So we want to encourage people to use digital methods more and more, as well as to actually expose what already have been produced by digital humanists in Europe today.
Thank you. So I come from the Nordic Council of Ministers. It's the intergovernmental collaboration between the Nordic countries. It's a long-standing collaboration since the 50s, really. It's true that it's a funding organization in the way that we fund a lot of projects, but primarily we are a political organization. We are coordinating collaboration between the governments of the Nordic countries, but we're also publishing a lot of outcome, a lot of projects outcome, and that's where I come into play, because I'm head of publishing, so I'm also a publisher, but more as an IGO or institutional publisher. So I have different perspectives on this, and I also have the privilege to be an independent expert reviewer for the European Commission, and as such I'm part of a review team of the Open Air project, which we've heard about, which is a great and interesting privilege to have. My background is academic publishing, so I've been at a small university press in Copenhagen, and as such been part of the OAPEN project. So that's where I got into open access publishing back when Framework 7 program started.
Thank you. My name is Andreas Degwitz, and I'm director of the Humboldt University in Berlin, the library of the Humboldt University in Berlin, and I'm chair of DINI, which is German Initiative of Network Information, and you can see DINI as a little brother or sister of CNI, because DINI, the paradigm for the foundation of DINI has been CNI. Well, Humboldt University is big university in Berlin and is a big university in Germany as well. We have 35,000 students and about 5,000 researchers on different levels. the open access publishing activities we cooperate closely with the Computer and Media Service, which is a computer center at Humboldt University, and in cooperation with the CMS, the Computer and Media Service, we have a good infrastructure with our repository eDoc server. And this eDoc server we have for a long time. And I think it's a quite good eDoc, quite good repository. We are highly ranked in the comparison with other repositories. But this is not the only infrastructure we have. We have infrastructures for research data. And of course, we have discipline-driven publishing activities since some years. One of these activities is the edition Topoi, which is the publication activity of one of the excellent clusters we have in Berlin. And Topoi is federated on Free University and Humboldt University. And we have another very interesting publishing activity from linguists. And these linguists the chief editor of these linguist activities is Stefan Müller, and he is in three universities before, and now he is at Humboldt University, and his coordinator, Sebastian Nordhoff, is sitting in the auditory. So we have also this discipline-driven activities for open access publishing in our university. So I'll tell more if you ask me some more questions. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Cliff Lynch. I'm here as director of the Coalition for Networked Information, which is an organization based in Washington, D.C. We bring together universities through their libraries and IT operations and other work, publishers, content creators of various kinds, foundations, technology providers. I've been involved, I'm realizing now, with scholarly electronic publishing in one form or another going well back into the 1980s, making available first very large abstracting and indexing databases, and then later as the technology got cheaper, online journals themselves. It's been very interesting watching how the technology interplay has reshaped the world several times during the period while I've been involved here. I've been at the Coalition for Networked Information since 1997, and we've been, of course, deeply engaged in the whole scholarly communications and practice of scholarship set of work. We've done a great deal of work with digital preservation, including strategies for large-scale digital preservation of journals. We've looked at how the genre of scholarly communications are changing and diversifying away from the old print-modeled paradigms. And most recently, we've also been quite involved in research data management and have also started engaging in some of the issues around privacy and analytics, especially as they relate to interactions with scholarly resources. So I come to this with a lot of different perspectives and interests, and I'm really delighted to be here.
So thank you all. I would really like to start the discussion from the researcher's perspective. So I'm looking here to my left and to your right, because we are a group of service providers, infrastructure providers, policymakers, but we're actually the system that is behind the wall, yeah, because all the services that we provide should come out of the wall, like electricity from the power plugs that I see in the wall there. And this only serves eventually the researchers, the scientific and scholarly communication. So we may have a lot of discussions, but the most important perspective, and I think we should never forget that, is that of the researchers. So I'm very interested. We're living in exciting times, and you already mentioned, Andrea, that we see changes, but from your perspective and the perspective of your colleagues in the natural sciences, because I can ask Mike maybe later for a humanities perspective, how do you see the current developments?
Yeah, and maybe I should start with a statement, and that is that I think that the freedom to make a decision where I publish, when I publish, what I publish, that is, I think, a very valuable and important asset which we have here, yeah? And that is something we really, I think, we can be proud of, and to some extent, maybe people think that or feel that they have to defend this, because many researchers nowadays feel that they are perhaps more or less forced to go open access, for example. And in some disciplines, like for example in my discipline, open access is really very, it's really great. It's great when you can afford it. Fortunately, I have to say, in our university, we really don't have that problem, because the university has set up funds to support researchers to publish open access. But I think in many places it's really a matter of concern, and I feel that if the scientific community has, let's say, to be concerned too much about who pays for this, then we will also get a separation of this community, which cannot be good and which is, I think, not very useful. I think another very important aspect is that nowadays it's not only about publishing papers, it's also about publishing data, and I think you made already that point, and that is another point about which we are sometimes a little bit concerned, because we are not really sure, I mean, what happens then with our data, who will be using it, how will these data be handled, do we lose control? And maybe these are some aspects which I would like to have discussed. I don't know whether perhaps open access publishers would like to comment.
Well, actually, yeah, well, why don't you go ahead directly? Yeah.
On publication of data?
I think specifically process is perhaps not so much so deeply involved in publication of data, but I mean, you're running an open access, a huge or many open access journals, and so you have a lot of experience. Also, experience, of course. Maybe another important aspect is the reviewers. Yeah, and for example, you have a more or less automatic reviewing system, which I find highly debatable.
I'm not quite sure what you mean by automatic. It's a collaborative peer review forum that we run, which means that that we have to have endorsement or rejection from two independent reviewers selected for expertise, and then it has to be also ratified by the handling editor. So you have to have three people. It's not automatic in any way, but we do have data articles, an article type, which is data. We also have coding article types and various other things that we try to make specific for fields, and these are available across all our journals. We do track where the data is used as much as we can. Obviously, we track citations as well as views and downloads. But I mean, the whole crux of open access is the trust in the use of data. I think that is an issue. And I think the publisher's role as curator of the content is difficult to maintain after the point at which it goes live. You know, we can help to improve that the paper, and we can help to publicize it once it's published, but after that, actually, the by nature, we cannot prevent its reuse. What do you think from the other publisher's perspective?
Probably more from a funder's perspective. I think making the data available is crucial. Of course, there are certain criteria you have to address, confidentiality and so on, personal data and all that. But I think it's becoming more and more evident that in order to be able to reproduce and to validate data and to work on research already taking place, it's very important to address the issue of open data. And obviously there are many, it's a complex matter, but and research agencies, at least across the Nordic countries, are deeply involved with this, and of course the European Commission as well. So I think it should be in a dialogue with the research community, obviously, but I think we should also be quite bold and set up some standards for what we can expect in terms of delivery of data. So we don't ourselves publish data, but we support a lot of projects that do that. And I think one initial experience has been that just to address the issue of research data management is is needed. So it's very interesting and crucial.
Let me just put in a comment on this whole business about open data. Open data has, I think, become a very powerful rhetoric and a very compelling goal, which many science policy organizations and government organizations and many many scholars themselves have gotten behind. And I think the benefits around it are really quite compelling, both in terms of supporting better scholarship through better paths to replicability and inspection of the processes, and also by facilitating reuse of data in new contexts. However, the danger we've got here, I think, is that this language of open data oversimplifies a bit, because a tremendous amount of data deals with people, either individually or in aggregate, medical records, genomic records, various kinds of sociological studies, all kinds of psychological studies, all sorts of things. And the vast majority of this data, at least under current regulations and law in the United States, is protected in various ways. Certainly, my understanding of most scholarly disciplines and their accepted ethical practices is that this data is normally kept private unless it's very explicitly released. And the evidence so far is that anonymization is a very limited, shall we say, and somewhat weak tool for protecting a good deal of this data. So it really seems to me that we should be thinking about honoring all of the motivations that are driving open data, but moving towards a more nuanced rhetoric about available data. Not necessarily fully open, but collecting private data of various kinds under constraints that still facilitate reuse and facilitate replication in a way that is compatible with these kinds of ethical and legal obligations. I think that there's a big gap and a big problem growing there that it's going to be critical for all of us to find ways to navigate.
I'd just like to perhaps extend the notion of academic freedom in a way, especially, I suppose, in the case of digital humanists. We've heard about the trap of hierarchy, the trap of rankings, and so forth. And digital humanists are engaged in creating lots of different types of research results. So there can be data, there can be algorithms and so forth, it can be critical scholarly editions, but very few of these new forms are actively or progressively or constructively recognized in research evaluation systems. So if you're an early career research, for example, you're faced with a freedom of choice in terms of method, if you like. But when it comes to publication and building your career, your freedom of choice is somewhat constrained if you want to make a rational decision. So it's important, I think, to also understand how can we extend the notion of academic freedom, not only in terms of method applied or subject chosen, but the form in which you publish, and also the impact that you can possibly have both within the academy and beyond the academy. I'm not here to speak for the commission, but as a research consortium mandated by the commission, if you like, the commission is also quite clear about the impact that should be had by the academy on society and perhaps on the economy as well. And that can only be achieved through greater openness. And how, I mean, I also take point about protecting people and so forth, but we have to find ways in which more than the academy, which is after all largely supported by taxpayers, as we've heard again today, is able to contribute as well to the broader society. But the most important thing, I think, for digital humanists is having greater freedom to express what they do at different stages of their research.
Am I here? Yeah. It is remarkable that when starting from talking about the conventional publishing system, we immediately dive into the question of data, which is, I think, a sign that there are very many diverse things and processes going on, maybe even disruptive processes. But I'm glad you bring up the topic of career relevance. And I think that the conventional publishing system, maybe let's stay at this point for a while before we're coming back into the open science realm and open data realm. In this conventional publishing system, is it so that we have already penetrated the whole community? We saw numbers here that showed actually it's still not there. We have worked on it for the last 15, 20 years, but so I would like to ask again, Andrea, also maybe from an institutional perspective or from the perspective of a representative of the Senate, because you hear all the discussions from the different disciplines and stakeholders. So how deep did we penetrate the system with open access?
Yeah, I think there are quite a number of disciplines which have really still a lot of, let's say, they are quite hesitant to accept this, especially in some branches of humanities. I think in science, it's the question, I think the question is not there anymore. Simply like this, because all the journals, at least all the journals I know, and I know really many, they at least they offer open access. I mean, you have to pay for it, but I mean, it's, you always have that option. And if you can afford, you would choose the option because, of course, it's good for your career if your work can be seen, if it can be downloaded and read by and recognized by anybody, yeah? And not only by, let's say, rich universities who can afford to have all the different journals. And therefore, I think that question that is perhaps maybe in my opinion, it's not something we will discuss anymore. Of course, I mean, for a scientific career, at least in the field of science, people will look in which type of journal you publish. Let's say if you publish in Nature, I think that is usually it will open you all the doors to a professorship and so on. And as far as I know, they usually always request that you make your work open access, and therefore it's also no question. But of course, if we now go to humanities, but here probably people who know better than me, then I think we still have a lot of discussion. And also, I think what we should not underestimate is that in most branches of science, we always have a lot of collaboration. So most of our work is somehow collaborative. because I know hardly any paper where we just have one author. And that is really different in humanities. And then the question also comes up with intellectual property and things like this. And we haven't touched this yet because I think that is also a very important point, yeah, which we could discuss here.
I think we have a very good penetration on the field of PhD thesis, for example. The repositories we have mostly a huge number of PhD theses in other work of the academic career. We don't have a good penetration for conference proceedings also in the repositories. The lack we have is that we don't get the publications of the first line in these repositories. We don't get it. And in concern of the humanities, there are two problems. The one problem is really that many of the humanists would like to publish in print. This is one reality we have still. And the other point is that the publishers of the humanities are mostly smaller publishers, smaller companies. They are not the big companies, the big publishing companies, which are responsible for the publishing of this research. And if you look at the development of opening the subscription to APCs, all the big publishers for natural science and so on are in the first line. So there is no opportunity for a humanist to get a journal and to pay APCs and a journal which is high ranked and so on. So I think that it takes another 10 years for the humanists that establish appropriate journals and appropriate publication channels for her research results. This is my impression from Humboldt, and I can say we are not so lucky like you that we have a publication fund. We don't have such a publication fund, and university doesn't agree with it yet, but now we try to get it with the strategy of the State of Berlin. But this is a sign for me, it is difficult to convince the people, and if the financial resources are not as big as we desired it, then the problems are rising up. So, and this problem we have at Humboldt, for example.
So just quickly, I want to entirely agree with your reading on open access and where that stands. And I want to just underscore it with an experience I had recently that brought this home to me. If you talk to scientists, there's, I think, a very, very broad consensus that the desired end state would be open access to the journal literature. There's a lot of debate about how to get there and how quickly and what the economic models are, but the access end state is clear. If you talk to humanists, many of the humanistic sciences, the key work is still the monograph. And there is not a clear consensus about whether open access, full open access, is the desirable end state. There really isn't a consensus, as best I can tell, on where they want to end up exactly. There is still a very strong commitment to print publishing, a lot of ambiguity about the relationship between print and digital works, and I think that absent that consensus, it will be very hard to move ahead other than incrementally and giving people lots of room to do what they individually feel is right for themselves in their particular sector of scholarship.
Well, some years ago we had a lot of discussions with humanist scholars about open access, and most of them actually thought it was a good idea, but not for their work. In Denmark we have, for instance, a national strategy for open access, which is It is rather vague, but the goals are very clear. So by 2021, 100% open access to all research journals made in Danish universities, which is a very ambitious goal. And as part of that exercise, an open access indicator has been made. So actually measuring for all Danish universities, where are we? And where are we? 18%. 18. This is only research articles. And within journals, actually, humanities is doing just as good as science in Denmark. But this also says something about academic freedom and the right to choose where you want to publish. Is that part of academic freedom? I think we should question that. And I think the research agencies should really reflect on this, because I think part of the problems with the current strategies are that there is a tendency not to interfere and not to sort of guide towards where you should publish, but that's part of the freedom of the researchers. So when you look at, for instance, the code of conduct for research in different countries, for instance, in Denmark, you will see that you could translate those rules in there really to the area of open access, which would be quite interesting, that not making your research publicly available is a kind of not conducting, is a misconduct perhaps. You could discuss such things. So I think although we conceptually are at a stage where open access is the default, there are many obstacles that we still need to address.
I think the question of the natural sciences collaborating more than the humanities, yes, of course, largely true, but I think that's also changing now. I think we have to differentiate the arguments, really, I suppose. So you will have many humanists saying that there is still a requirement for the long argument, and therefore the long argument also, the natural form of the long argument is a monograph. That may be a print monograph, but it may also be an enhanced publication. It may be of that long argument length in a way, but the richness that you can gather and garner today will only be possible if other people make their data available. So even if you're an individual researcher and you're not collaborating, you directly, that is, you will still be able to benefit from the fact that others in the background are supplying data or algorithms and so forth to enhance any particular publication you have in front of you. So I think I think quite often arguments are conflated. Yes, is it really print we're looking at, or the long argument as a method? So I'd argue for trying to unpack that a little bit more.
Yeah, maybe I should also add at this point that the European Commission is aiming at 100% open access 2020. And I think it will be an interesting tension over the next years between these arguments for academic freedom and scholarly needs on the one hand, and the funders' requirement and even ethical powers on the other hand, coming through scientific conduct considerations. So, but it seems that we have not the question if, and probably we're all not surprised about it. It will happen in one way or another. It might go faster or slower. Might not be 100%, but only 95%. We maybe don't know that. I would be interested in your views on what do you think will be the driving forces, talking about power. Will it be the funders? Will it be the publishers? Or will it be disruptive developments like we're currently observing with things like Sci-Hub? I mean, considering the development of open access over the last years, it was always very polarized, the discussion, but looking at the results, it seems to be a very, very continuous growth, actually. There was not really a disruptive development over the last 10, 15 years. Is somebody of you thinking that we will have disruption, or how will it develop in the next years? Do you want to start?
Thank you. I agree with you. I think it's more a process of slow cultural change, particularly perhaps in the humanities. It's sort of what you were talking about, is that the resistance is still greater in some fields than in others. There is a cultural change that's needed there. Obviously, some fields are less advantaged with funding than others as well. Governmental funding tends to prioritize the sciences and socially beneficial research like that. Obvious perception of benefit, so that the humanities are often left a little underfunded. You know, that this is a perception, not a reality, I hasten to add. I'm just saying that as a publisher talking to humanities academics, what you hear again and again is, I cannot afford to publish with APC charges. And this is less of an issue for scientists than it is, from our perception, than it is for humanities academics. So, I mean, I think there's a sort of a sea change needed, and it's going to need to come from a mandate from national initiatives. I think that there's a lot of as we know, the EU is aiming for 100% by 2020, but exactly how that's going to be actioned, it's going to need to be split down into national initiatives and then into perhaps field initiatives as well, across science, across humanities, across social science. And we're going to need to see publishers engaging with that. Perhaps mandates need to be imposed on publishers as well. That they shouldn't have necessarily free rein to act as they please. Perhaps there should be national initiatives on those that would help impress this cultural change, which is so widespread, but needs to gather its full strength, I think. Anyone else like to?
Do you expect a real push from the recommendation of the European Council about the open access is 100% until 2020? Do we expect, as a publisher of Frontier, a real push by this announcement?
We'd love to say that that would be the perfect outcome from the point of view of an open access publisher. The reality is that the same problems will persist and that exist now. And unless there is more funding made available for academics who currently cannot afford author publishing charges, this is exactly what was being addressed earlier, that we have a revenue problem, a revenue flow problem with APCs. So unless something wider spread is done to address that on a whole economic level, then we are going to have problems. My suggestion was a mandate on publishers to give more waivers and to make this more of a feasible argument, which is something that the publisher I work with is very keenly aware of and aims to do. But as I say, when you're talking about huge fields of academics who are less financially supported than perhaps scientists are, then you're talking about a much wider issue. So I would love to say, yes, it's going to be a tidal surge of papers coming our way, but I suspect actually it'll be more gradual.
Yeah, but I feel that there seems to be a kind of gold rush at the moment anyway, because all these open access journals pop up like mushrooms out of the soil. So. I think that is also something that is sometimes difficult, especially for the young scientists to really know where should I go, where should I publish, and I mean how, let's say, sustainable is a certain publisher, because that is, I think, also a very critical issue.
At least on this point, there's good news from the local library. So if your young researchers are not sure where to publish, then please call us. For instance, Sabine, Witt and me, we are there. I mean, if it scales up, we probably can't do it anymore because we can't really help researchers to find the right publishing decision. But for the time being, this is what we're actually happy to do. And we try to teach on that subjects.
I wanted to say many more experts than me in this room about this subject. But I suspect it probably consists of, the answer consists probably of a combination of two things. You can possibly use that impact factor, that kudos factor, or research assessment factor in favor of more openness on the part of any academic, any research, I suppose. So I take your point, it would probably have to be translated into national moves in terms of research councils and so forth. But also, we're bandying around this idea of, can I afford this APC or can I not afford this APC? But we've also heard today a plea to librarians to get more actively involved in publishing and so forth. Many are. But the question of what does an APC cost is maybe a red herring, to the extent that if there are different forms of publication, different ways of doing it, different institutions involved in publication, then the costs and the maintenance, those questions will be changed in any case. So I think confusing the entire question of open access with can I afford it, am I getting the money to do that, because there's this particular cost at the moment, is excluding a whole range of possibilities.
Let me jump on that and use it as kind of a lead back to what I think your original question was about disruptive versus, sort of slow evolution. I think at some level, the growth of open access stuff, particularly in the scientific journals, the vector is clear. There are some questions about rates and about what this does to the economics, but I think you hinted, maybe a little more than hinted, at the real disruptor here, or potential disruptor. If you look at a typical scientific paper right now, you will see something, maybe it has a little more color illustration, the typography is a little different, but if you woke up someone from 1915, they would have no trouble recognizing that form and what was going on here. Yeah, there'd be a couple of weird things in there that said HTTP/, but fundamentally, they would be very comfortable with what that form of scholarly communication was and how to make one. The tools have certainly changed and they'd have to catch up with that. Now, quite separate from all of this economic kind of activity and open access activity related to the economics of journals, there's something else that's creeping up here, which is this whole discussion about moving beyond the PDF, if you will, about how we develop various genres of scholarly communication that are more effective, more timely, that offer much greater richness and depth and other important attributes. And you see wonderful explorations of this starting to happen in some parts of the humanities. You see it a bit less in the sciences. Sure, you can point at some things. Certainly, you can point at the growth of databases. You can see some very innovative things about workflow capture, the whole data discussion. But the fundamental scientific article is under pressure from a number of sources. There are people who really want to rethink this object into something quite different. And the implications of that are, multitudinous. Preservation, for example. Now, sorting out the preservation of scientific journals as we know them today, as they've moved to digital form, has been messy, and there's been a lot of hard work that's had to be done there, but much of it is economic and organizational and legal. The basic technical pieces of that weren't that hard. When you start talking about how we preserve over long periods of time these new genre materials as opposed to things that emulate paper, there are some very hard intellectual and technical problems there that we don't really understand the answers to. But we can't make that transition in communication without a concomitant way of ensuring that the new genres are not ephemeral. So that's part of the struggle here. The last issue that I'll just put on the table among the very many involved here, because that switchover is really going to change the landscape if and when it happens. And it could happen quite quickly. The last thing we never talk about is author time and author levels of effort. Now, if you look in the humanities, people who write monographs are already making these incredible commitments. Many humanities projects are very big kind of long-term efforts. So the additional digital overhead is somewhat more manageable. But when you look at scientists who are trying to get a result out quickly, you know, 60 days of refereeing cycle is horribly infuriating, potentially career busting if someone else gets there first. It matters how long authorship takes and how much work it is. And yes, you are seeing these big team science sorts of things that put a lot of material in the highest prestige journals. Professor Guidon, you did a beautiful job earlier today reminding us of how they've brought competition into this and the various implications of that. Those top tier journals are so competitive that no level of effort is too much if you can get in there. And I rather suspect for many of these large scientific teams now you're seeing communication specialists who are part of the team and are there to build wonderful multimedia presentations for the funders, and it really doesn't matter much. You know, that's just one more part of doing that kind of science. But for the individual or very small group fighting the scientific competition game, I'm very concerned about the additional barrier to entry that we may see in there. So I'm looking to that whole area as the place where we may see disruptions from unexpected sources.
Mm-hmm. That's very, very interesting. I once published a monograph which was based on 30 years of work in Greenland, which was a very good monograph, but a lot of work. But
spending 2 weeks to make that better.
There was a box of, you know, loads of papers that had to be organized. Anyway, now coming back to your question, I sometimes think that it would be great to have some more public engagement in the whole question of open science. I mean, I rarely read any, articles in the newspapers, or whenever there is something, nobody comments on it. So it's not really, it's not an issue. And I think, the taxpayers' union in the States was, you know, pushing the whole open access movement in the beginning. And I think, for instance, some years ago in 2009, John Horton, the Australian economist, he did some very interesting studies in some European countries, showing the potential in economic terms that we could save when having a green open access model. So such studies could bring, you know, meat on the table for politicians, for everybody to engage in these discussions, because it tends to become very technical and introvert and not something that some politician would stand up for or go to elections for and so on. So that kind of engaging public, the public would be interesting. And I think the Commission is really trying to also have this citizen science engagement, so there are different angles to it, which I think could be very interesting to explore to actually, or maybe disrupt the system in unexpected ways.
I would like to know, I mean, listening to this several processes and dynamics that we observe, and we keep coming back to the data question and to the atomization of publishing units and new models of publishing. We have a very established system for the journal article, and it's probably for a reason, because it has developed over several centuries, actually as a quite stable unit of communication, which is under pressure now at the moment. But when we come to data, when we come to smaller forms of units being published, and I think some of you mentioned that, there is one question that seems to be largely unresolved, and that is ownership. So who is actually owning? I mean, there are several people here, maybe a funder would say, well, you know, we fund it, so we own it, yeah? And, or if it's taxpayers funding, and you would say so even more, yeah? It's the taxpayers funding, the citizens own the material. The publishers are starting to move into the market in a way of getting data IPR'd, which is I think a fundamental question itself, whether this is possible or not. But then the researchers probably would say, well, no, it's me, we own it, yeah, we produce the data. This is something that doesn't seem to be 100% clear. I would like to start with the researchers again. What do you think? Who owns your data? Your data.
Actually, that is really a long discussion we are having, because if you work in large research consortia like a CRC or so, then you are obliged to deposit your data in a repository. And then the question is immediately there, who owns these data? I mean, is it me? Is it perhaps a PhD student who actually produced the data? Or is it perhaps the German Science Foundation funded this, and so on? So, I mean, so far, I think we do not really have a clear answer to this. Yeah, because a PhD student, often after 3 years, the person would be gone. And then, I mean, if there are requests, who is responsible also to deal with this? And so on and so on. So I think it's really a very difficult question, also questions about intellectual property. And I mean, sometimes I think that maybe we should talk more to people like people in technical universities, where you, let's say, work with, let's say, the car industries or something like this, because I mean, there must be ways how to protect this and how to deal with this. And maybe we have to look at this in a similar way. But I mean, currently, I can just say we are in huge discussions about this, and we have no clear answer. I mean, we have regulations and we adhere to them, but I mean, that this is already the end, I doubt.
May I comment? I'll come to you. I think, I wonder if maybe the question of ownership is not the right word. Maybe the question of credit is the right word. So that if we're all behind the general picture of open access, that publicly funded research becomes publicly available and that everyone can access this, I think we're all behind that picture, as we've said. The general big picture is that people do accept this becoming the future. But if we're all behind that, then surely the citation is the crucial thing, that we credit the creation of the data to the correct person and the funding of the data to the correct person, but that actually we all have access to it, and therefore ownership becomes perhaps the wrong word to use in terms of open access.
Would I briefly answer to this? Yeah, I think I also have this opinion. But I mean, when you do a lot of field work, really hard field work, and you generate a very good data set, and you publish your tiny little paper on this data set, and then many people do this, and then we have these so-called synergy groups and so on, and they come and they collect all this, yeah, and they make the big Nature papers and so on. And they use us, let's say, as their data production, I don't want to say slaves, but I mean, it's of course still our decision whether we contribute to those projects or not. Then I think it becomes a little bit, let's say, debatable. or are they obliged? Because, I mean, they really put a lot of thinking into this, yeah? I don't want to minimize their impact here. Or do they always have to include all of us as co-authors? I think it's a big question.
I just wanted to take up your point about looking to different industries, maybe. But I'll address that in a moment. The question of ownership also comes up in terms of what some of the things that DARIAH is looking to achieve, which is why I asked the question I asked yesterday of DARIAH Andrews, in terms of, say, a cultural heritage institution makes a digital object available, a researcher has free access to that object at relatively, well, more or less zero cost to them, if you like. They will produce annotations on the back of that object. Now, should there be not an obligation for that researcher to make those annotations available again to the originating institution, so those things can be augmented? They belong only to the researcher for their publication. What kind of sort of barter or knowledge economy do you want to be creating of mutuality, perhaps? That's a very open question as well, but that's one area where the question of ownership becomes a very important one, because archives, as you say, I mean, it's a question not of ownership but of recognition. If you're an archive, you make things available at the moment. There aren't really very straightforward ways of an archive manager saying to the person funding them, oh, I've had impact in several articles in this environment, say, for the REF in the UK, therefore I've had a research impact, and there it is. You can't really do that. You can't cite an archive and that's very easily. So I think attribution or recognition is also an extremely important part of this. But I think in the world of mobile technology, of smartphones and so forth, I think there's something called FRAND, where major companies cross-license things because they know they can't actually produce. You can't produce a wireless handset without the ability to use a wireless protocol. If one company copyrighted that wireless protocol, there'd be just one company producing a mobile phone. So there'd be a complete monopoly. It also happens in the automotive industry as well. So is there a way of actually adopting these ways of addressing questions of ownership, I wonder?
Let me just make this a little bit even worse from the U.S. perspective, and I should precede my remarks by just saying I'm not a lawyer. I'm simply relying on what I've been told by people who I think know what they're doing. Under U.S. law, and I realize it's different over here, facts cannot be protected by copyright. When we talk about ownership in the sense that academics speak of, you know, owning their texts, the fundamental thing that makes that work is that the text is protectable, which means you have a copyright, and then you can talk about, do you transfer it, or does it rest with your employer as a condition of employment? But the basic fact of ownership makes all of that discussion possible. Now, with many compilations of data, there is no protection. It's inherently in the public domain. So what this becomes all about is not the data itself is protected, but who gets access to it. So it really revolves around control much more than it does some inherent right in the data. And that's just a further deep complication, especially when there are constraints on that control for various reasons by whoever's exercising it.
Just to comment on that, because I completely agree, it's a very complex issue. Especially because you have so much data which is openly available, which could never have ownership to it. But there's a level when you apply a method, when you manipulate the data and it turns into a data set, then it's an entity which you may be able to. Yeah. But as from a funding point of view, we had this discussion quite a lot about ownership to data sets. And I mean, we don't want to own the data because what should we use it for? But we want to ensure the right to reuse that data. So attribution, DOI, ORCID, you have these tools so you can make attribution, ensure good metadata for the data, and make sure that it's openly available, acknowledging all the bots, if and so on. But at least we don't need to own the data. Sorry, there was a...
I thank Cliff for his remark, because I was playing around the same ternary situation of credit control and ownership. And in a sense, I think, although you say you complicate it, I think you just helped simplify it. Ownership is impossible, essentially. So what you have to really deal with is control, and in the name of what? Now, there are the analogies we can use are not very easy, but for example, I know one case in the humanities which might be similar to this kind of data. Some people wanted to work, I think, on some Nietzsche's manuscripts. Now, of course, the text by Nietzsche is absolutely in the public domain, but the paper on which the thing is an object which is owned by someone. So an institution could definitely claim ownership over the material support of the data, and then relinquish control for a certain period of time to those who have produced the data, and then once everybody is satisfied that this situation has been exploited about as well as one can do, then release it, and hopefully other people will do even better with that data. But at least for a little while, the producers would be protected, and at the same time, I think your complicating factor actually helps simplify it. I don't know if that's...
I think you're quite right about that, and there have been, you know, wonderful examples of that, the Dead Sea Scrolls notably, which were, you know, closely held for a long time. The other thing I just want to mention, though, because it keeps me up a lot lately, worrying about aspects of this, and I don't want to take us too far off track, is we are not doing very well as organizations worldwide at protecting data. You know, when you look at the number of data breaches of various kinds that have occurred in very high profile ways over the last few years, I really worry that we have not sufficiently internalized our ability to secure most data and the implications of people going around making copies of things and making things very public despite well-intentioned but ineffective efforts of organizations is becoming more and more of a reality.
I would like to open the floor here for if there are questions from the audience. Jean-Claude, maybe could you just keep the microphone?
Thank you. Can I take it to Canada as a souvenir? No, I just wanted to go back to the question of academic freedom, because in a sense, I have the feeling this is a false question. There is one element that has not been mentioned at all today, which is also part of the open access movement. It's the green route and the repositories. So if you accept that an article can be deposited into a repository, a person can publish absolutely anywhere. Now you're going to say, oh yes, but there are some publishers, etc. Well then you go into the dark archive and you put the famous request button. It becomes a private matter between two people to get that particular article. It doesn't entirely liberate the whole thing, I agree with that. It puts all sorts of constraints, but a lot of at least eyeball desires are being satisfied. So I do think that the issue of academic freedom is a little bit too much intensified for its own good. It can be really treated this way. Now, if we go that route though, there is one real important problem to solve, which has never been well solved. It's the question of versioning, you know, the versions of the documents. And I think, Cliff, I heard you speak about that years ago already at some conference where we crossed each other's path. And I would recommend that some international group organizes itself a bit the way Larry Lessig organized the Creative Commons thing, and develop a sort of system in which the versions would be very carefully defined, but also would be accompanied by machine-readable code, which could be input into the metadata of that document. So that when you pull an article from a repository, particularly if it has been in a dark archive, you would have the version of that document, and you could say, I can cite this document in that particular version. There would not be any ambiguity, and it would allow the whole flow of scientific and scholarly thought to proceed in an orderly fashion. If you have disagreements about a citation, check first if you are talking about the same version. We already do that when we cite books. Is it a first edition or a second edition? So there's nothing really new about this, but we've got to formalize it in the area of the repositories. And I think that would be a beautiful project for open air.
Just want to add to that. So GitHub is already doing that for software. So yeah. The principles is very easily ported to repository, just taking them a long time to do this. So and so that's why I think a lot of people are already depositing their papers in GitHub and FigShare, and because there are version controls available.
I mean, there is one community that doesn't seem to have such an amount of problem with that, and that is the archive community. But it is interesting to have a biologist here with Andrea. Did you hear about bioarchive? Because this is trying to implement an idea that has been established in the field of high energy physics, or basically it's a LaTeX community, but now trying to implement it in a completely different field with other publication cultures. Did you hear anything about it?
Unfortunately, I have to say no.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm aware, for example, that in mathematics and so on, they use this kind of system really, I think, for quite a long time. But in biology or medical sciences and so on, or ecology, I mean, at least in ecology, what I can say there, we also have quite a number of repositories. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But otherwise, that is not very common. I think a point is also that often, let's say, the data structure is always so different that it's, let's say, very difficult to set up some common rules, whereas in ecology, that is easier to handle, at least also from my point of perspective. But maybe talking about these repositories, I think there's also a difference whether we talk, let's say, about very common and accessible repositories, or whether we talk about a lot of university repositories, like I think we have Büsgen-Institut, for example, because for us as scientists, it's very difficult to find the stuff in those repositories. Yeah, of course, I can search by Google, or when I know Büsgen-Institut, I can search. But I mean, I usually don't find the things I need to find. And that is, I think, one of the major, in my opinion, obstacles against this type of repository. Of course, you are right. I mean, as an author, if I deposit my preprint paper there, I'm fine because I did my duties for the EU. But this is for me more like a bureaucratic act and nothing, let's say, to serve the community.
It's also an ethical act.
Well, I think it's very important that we establish and improve our repositories. Otherwise, we will go in this APC trap of the big publishers. And this is my fear if I hear this recommendation of the European Council. If they say they want to have 100% open access until 2020, Many, many, of course, maybe you pick it up with branches, and this is okay. But of course, there will go on an enormous marketing machine from Elsevier, Wiley, and Springer, and they will convince the researcher and said, you have to do this until 2020, and please do it with us. So, and if the result of this movement is that the open access movement is handed over to the big publishers, it is open, but it's nothing else. And so we have to be better with our repositories. You are completely right. And there have to be less repositories, more focus on disciplines, not every university with one institutional body, and so on. These repositories are not good enough for acceptance by researchers. And when it's not good enough, researchers go to the traditional publishers. It is so. This is, I'm afraid.
Yes, I agree, and I think I mentioned the John Horton study. 2009, that was on the green route, and it was big amounts of money that could be saved by using it, but I completely agree we need to have better services in the repositories, and a very good, we have already a European infrastructure to I mean, we have the Open Air project, but you also then have to make that better. I mean, you have to focus on this, and I think there's still a way to go. But again, if you can show that there is a very good business case and there is a very good case for the community, then that should be, that message should be brought to the right people.
Well, there is also that research infrastructure, that there are several contributions in DARIAH that can already cater for that. So, and I'll probably refer to Pierre Monnier here to some extent, but there's, you know, one contribution to DARIAH is HAL, it's a French-based archive for preprints. So it's available to anybody to use. So these things already exist. It's a question of probably people like DARIAH working with librarians and others to actually broadcast this information more so that the people do know when they have that question in front of them posed by publishers, you know, do this by 2020 or else, they can say, well, actually, already did it. And with this infrastructure that already was pre-existing. But these things do exist.
About improving the services we provide, repositories, discovery mechanisms, in compatibility issues, protocols, whatever. I think to succeed, we have to think, we as universities, libraries, academic institutions, have to think a little bit more business-wise in a way that to achieve all of this, it needs investment. And commercial companies are very good in this. They are investing money and they are reaping the rewards. They might have very, very high profits. And actually, they are selling their products, and we are the ones who are paying for this. So what I'm saying is that instead of just paying the subscriptions for Science Direct, if we the academic community could spend 1% of that money we pay for Science Direct for putting it to innovation, doing it collectively, I think it would be profitable for us.
Yeah, well, it seems that maybe the green and gold route is about to close its discussion and differentiation. So this question about next generation repositories and APCs that are being actually broken up into smaller units, like for example Copernicus shows, having open processes of quality assurance, is a completely new route, new units of publication, new forms genres, as Cliff mentioned. So it's versioning is, I think, Jean-Claude, it's a beautiful idea about having this machine readable readability of three or four different kinds of versions. Yeah? That's I think a very, very clever idea. We're coming to a close, and I would just like to ask you in this respect, in looking into the future, into the possibility of new forms of publishing, next generation repositories, what is the opposite of, or what is keeping you awake as a one aspect of a projection or your projection of the future, and what is not putting you to sleep, but what is making you very comfortable? What thought about how the world of electronic publishing and LPUB 2021 would be the 25th anniversary, right? So in 2021 would look like. What keeps you awake? What makes you feel comfortable?
What keeps me awake may sound strange, but is this question of participation. It's been mentioned quite a few times during the conference in citizen science. And citizen science is often bandied about as a phrase, but it's not really invested in very heavily, or as much as it should be, in my view, by the academic community, in the sense of enabling citizens to do research rather than perhaps bringing citizens in to augment research, refine research processes. And I think, go back to the Digital Humanities Manifesto, it looked at this convergence between the culture, the data culture out there in the wider society, and the data culture was growing up within academia, and creating an advantage there for both groups by focusing on the fact that data can be widely and easily shared if the circumstances are right. So that keeps that bothers me slightly. I'd like to see more progress there. What makes me feel comfortable is things such as the attitude I saw today in our speaker who talked about early career researchers. So there is in that younger generation an appreciation of what is out there, what is possible, what ought to be done. And also there is also a very strong, almost moral imperative to make this stuff work not only for academics, but for society. And I can already see it there. So that makes me feel a lot happier.
From my point of view, what keeps me awake and what lets me sleep are one and the same thing, really. It's technology for me. So what keeps me awake about it is that I worry that with the advances of technology, we are struggling to protect data. The hacks are getting more and more clever. Also the content curation may be slipping. You were mentioning mushrooming journals that are kind of getting in on the gold rush. There's no way to curate those or to prevent those from happening. On the other hand, the technology is giving us, as I said when I introduced myself, really unlimited possibilities for improving publishing for academics, the way they want it to be, the way we can make it work. And this is something which Frontiers is very dedicated to, and I'm sure other publishers are going to take that opportunity as well as the technology continues to advance. Things like the indexing capabilities, which Claude's versioning would require, and this sort of capability is there. And if we can collaborate, then I think the technology is what lets me rest as well.
What makes me comfortable is, I mean, it is nowadays so much easier to find the journals, to find the articles, than it used to be, let's say, even 10 years ago or so. When I started here in Göttingen, I had always to go to different places to find a journal here and in the chemistry and in the biology and so on. And I think this is really, it's really progress, yeah? It's really great. But of course, on the other hand, what makes me, why I'm concerned is, I mean, we see the growth, yeah? We have more and more journals, more and more articles, and it is more and more difficult, really, to keep up with this. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I'm really worried, I mean, how can we handle this? Or do we say, okay, I will just read, let's say, from impact 5 on upwards or something like this. What is, I think, is happening nowadays. Mm-hmm. And ignore the rest. And I don't think that is always so fair and so good.
Worries, there are a few. I'll just, one thing we haven't touched upon is digital preservation. I think that's a big worry, which is not being, I mean, we addressed it yesterday. But another thing which is a worry to me, or which, I don't know, worries me, is that that we still have this incentive structure which is based on competition, as we were talking about this morning, rather than collaboration. I would hope that by 2021 we would be in another place in LPOP context, seeing that this has been changed. But then again, there are many things that make me happy, and on a personal note, I think that the growing attention to open access monographs and really refining the structure for open access monographs is something I really am happy about.
Well, I think the internet has an enormous potential, and this potential didn't come to its end. And every day we learn more about this potential. And so I'm sure that people understand that they work in the 21st century and not in the 19th century. This is my hope. And I observe in universities, I'm sorry for that, that many, the majority of people think they are really in the 19th century still. Concerning, may concern the humanists and some others, but the traditions are very strong, but they will break because the internet is so attractive.
There are lots of things that keep me up worrying at night. Many of them these days revolve around large data analysis and some of the social implications of that, and would take us far afield. I would say very, very germane to this conversation. I share with you the concern that the pressures to publish, to just, you know, keep pumping stuff out, endless journals, endless articles, are not being effectively matched by methods of filtering and discovery. So we've got a system here where people are burning a tremendous amount of time publishing stuff that I'm not sure is getting sorted very effectively or getting to the places it needs to be. And some of this goes back to this hyper-competitive situation that was illuminated earlier, plus the abdication by various parties of genuine assessment of scholarly contribution in favor of numerical kinds of indicators of articles published and impact factors and other sorts of voodoo. This is something that is going to, is on the verge, I think, of really spiraling out of control, and we're going to need to deal with it. The other is this whole question of new forms of communication, and you know my particular fear there, and it's already coming true at least in isolated instances, is some of the best innovation that's being done is outrunning our ability to preserve it. Our commitments, our will to preserve, and that sets up, I think, for me a very bad situation for scholarship, where more things are de facto becoming quite short-lived, and enormous effort and insight is just ultimately being dropped on the floor.
Is there also something that makes you feel comfortable?
Yeah, I feel pretty good about...
No pun.
I feel pretty good about the whole, shape of the open access discussion, and particularly the deep commitment we're seeing from many younger scholars to the kind of underlying principles here. This is going to be in very good hands. Yeah.
Thank you very much for doing the honors of your famous closing words. I mean, who has participated in that many conferences with Cliff as I did, who knows that he's always doing these fantastic summaries. It's a pleasure to listen to you and all of you. Thank you so much. I have a little present for you. Surprisingly, it's a craftsmanship from Göttingen, and it's not something you would expect. It's coffee. Because they have, they're now they're re-establishing the tradition of actually importing coffee and roasting it here in a very fair way with specific providers in Bolivia. You will be happy about that, hopefully. So, thank you, Andrea. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks. Oh, I have one too little, actually. So you give yours because I give you another one. Because I can give you another one. He's from Göttingen, yeah. So, thanks, Cliff. Okay. All right, let's thank the speakers again.